for coming, and hi Sarah, and thank you so much for coming all the way to England to be our guest over the next 10 days. Tonight we start a learning retreat in the Cotswolds, about an hour away from here. We're expecting some more guests, partners from Maasai, from the Yaqui and Comcat communities in northern Mexico. And some of our core staff at InsightShare are all spending the next 4 or 5 days together in a learning retreat. And then next week we have a couple of events for our Indigenous partners to speak about their work in Oxford and in London next week. So if any of you are free for those, we'd be lovely to see you at those events as well. So, could you briefly describe the use of participatory video in Nagaland and perhaps touch on what would be the main advantages of using the tool from your point of view?
Good afternoon, and thank you, Nick and Michelle. And all of you for having me here. It's something that I feel that people from our community hardly get to interact with other side of the world. And this is a good opportunity to understand each other and also to share the kind of knowledge that we have. So thanks to everybody. As far as participatory video is concerned, we have started using this participatory video in 2014. That's the time, I should call it the perfect time, that Nordis Network is lucky enough, because it was just a month back that we had the first training for our women farmers on video documentation. But the concept of PV was not there. It was just technical know-how, and the whole objective was to give that technical know-how to our women farmers so that we can document our own stories. We can also share our perspective, our voices to the larger forum, to the larger outreach. Participatory video in 2014 September, which a colleague from InsightShare came all the way to our side of the country, I should say the place where we first have our participatory video training was in Tuensang, an eastern part of Nagaland, which is very difficult to reach, not even like the place where I come from. So it was NESFAS, another organization based in the northeastern region, and Northeast Network and InsightShare came together. We identified the local youths from my community. We have two from the other community, the Tinungam tribe, which is the other side in the eastern part of Nagaland, very close to Myanmar border. Two of them were selected, and that's how like the first training was taken place in a place where we ourselves as Northeast Network based in another part of Nagaland have not been to. So it's been like meeting a new area, new people, where we started learning together. We have our colleague, one of my colleagues who have gone there as a translator. So it was a good learning, a good start since then. Because the kind of knowledge that we got through the PV, it's not only handling about video cameras or taking photography or taking interviews, but it is more than that, because it's very participatory in the process, like where the storyboard is created, where the participants along with the community people is taken into the board and discuss what stories they want to document. So that itself was like a beginning of another powerful tool in our existing work. Northeast Network, which I will be sharing later on, is a women's organization. And we have been like into different work, which we have started by our pioneers 23 years back. So with participatory video, it was a plus point in the work that we are doing, because it's very powerful. It can reach more people. And that has been quite helpful for our organization, because once our young friends got training from them, then there was no going back, because it has created us some, you know, like they have given the equipments. Hardly we get training programs now and then from different groups and all, but leaving the equipments for us to work on it, that is very rare. And that's what like my friends, they were lucky enough to have that kind of opportunity. So once they came back from the training, they started using this. Of course, we as facilitators in the Northeast Network, we have been behind our two friends who got the training in also helping out the kind of like conceptual understanding they need while interacting with the communities, while interacting on the issues of livelihood, on you know, traditional knowledge, on you know, cultural aspects of the people. So that kind of support we were giving. And since then, I think in a year's time, they could make short films, 9 films, which is to do with, you know, like the kind of agriculture that we have, the kind of, you know, social setup that we have in the community. And there was a continuous hand holding, which I should say, like from our place, we send the video clips. And then from Oxford, they will give us the feedback, okay. So, you know, like the kind of network connectivity and all was not very good. And I remember sitting the whole night up, sending one video clip because it was so slow. But I think those were the struggles along the way. Other than that, we have been using this, and there were, you know, like appreciations even from our community, more participation from them. It was it's a new thing that our own people are documenting our own stories. And there was, you know, like willingness from the community. There was even like, you know, like encouragement, lots of encouragement from both young and old. And I think that was a good going. I very much feel that we have lots to do, because we have started touching only on the livelihood issues, on the, you know, like the agricultural kind of, you know, some different livelihood options that our people have. We have started using it, but we strongly feel that we will be taking along this participatory video on other issues also.
Thank you. Thinking about the two young women who took part in the training, how do you feel, well, has learning how to make videos made a difference to the lives of Vizuli and Lily, and if so, how?
Yes, definitely. These two friends of ours who have been part of the training program, who have taken the TV forward, Vizuli, of course, like she is orphaned, like she lives with her brother, both parents' side. She is a cultivator and also a weaver. And in no way like she could continue her studies after her class 10. Also with Lele, who passed her class 10, and then she went for some technical training in Kohima near in our state capital. But have to come back because of the you know, the financial problems at home, because parents are cultivators and, you know, weavers. So Lele has come back to the village, has been her parents in the cultivation, and also as a weaver. Her mother used to be a very good weaver, so both of them used to sit back sometimes at home and then they leave. So with this opportunity, it was a life-changing opportunity for them, because side by side with the agricultural work, they started documenting. It was a new opportunity for them. It was also a new, you know, like, a new way that has paved, you know, the community people to recognize their contribution. So it has given them, I should say, empowerment, definitely. It has also given them an opportunity to interact with other communities. It has given them a much, much wider space for them to go and then interact within our own community members, just giving them encouragement. Just time, you know, that we see them with cameras, and we also see them interacting with the communities, also in a group meetings while having a participatory community screening. We could see them like taking the lead role over behind the stage. And that's for them, it must be something else. But for us as facilitators, for somebody who tried to connect people with, you know, like different people, who tried to pave a platform for people to come together, for me, it's something that I've been, I should say, I was very proud and happy myself.
We should say that the young women won an award, a very prestigious award last year with the Community Media Trust. There's a community media film festival in India, and they won the first prize with their video, one of their videos, and flew all the way down to receive their prize down to, you know, over 1,000 miles down to Andhra Pradesh, and they were in the newspapers. And, so they have achieved a lot as well. Have there been any negative impacts? I say that not, I'm talking about the individuals at first before we talk about the wider process. I say that because in Mexico, the video collective is largely made up of women as well. There are a few men, but it's mainly the active ones are women. And there were some tensions, especially in the early years, whenever they had to travel to go do trainings in the other territories, because in Mexico we had a situation where we had half the group was from the Comcac or Seri tribe on the coast, and half the group were Yaquis, and it was always designed in that way. So we, from the start, the whole program was trying to bring together two tribes that are otherwise quite disparate. And so often the trainings involved a long travel to another place, and the husbands of the women would often be very uncomfortable, and there'd be a lot of tensions. Sometimes, you know, even coming and disrupting workshops, you know, drunken husbands coming and disrupting workshops and so on, and saying, "What are you doing? And who are you with?" And they found ways to resolve that. I'm just curious whether that anything like that has happened, or you felt that.
Not really. With our two participating women, so not with them, but of course, like with the women farmers, too, we have trained. Some of them find it difficult to move out when they come to Chisami for training, refresher course, or even like coming up to Kohima during the film festival we had this year in August. So there were some kind of, but not with our two friends, Lele and Vizuri. Though Vizuri had to leave her participatory video work to join her husband in Kohima. So after that, like, she has not come back to the village. So she got married and she has left. So while she was in the village with her brother, there is no such tension as such.
One of the ways that they resolved the problem in Mexico was to invite their husbands to come with them on the trainings. And Annabella's husband became the driver, and he's at first reluctantly, but then now he absolutely loves it because he finds it fascinating as well. He has a lot to contribute, and you can see that he can contribute just like any of the other participants. So it's that's been really interesting. We can learn talk more about that during the week and share. You know, stories of how to
With our other works, like with weavers that we do, that the initial years, like the husbands, the family members think that, okay, this is why you're going so much to Nen to get that. You can't work here or what. Those kind of complaints used to be there, but we were told amazing stories like that. Now that within their own homes, when women started, you know, to bring extra income to and contribute to the household, then there was, you know, some changes where the women were sharing that even the man helps them at home, like doing the other roles, which usually was done by women. So there was also like the gender roles were somehow changed, and those were the stories that we also got, but not with our two friends.
How has watching the videos, you described the community screenings, and I was at one of those screenings in your village in February 2015, and there were about 400 people that came, ranging from, you know, two or three-year-olds to all the elders. It was an amazing experience, and especially seeing Lily and Lizuli managing that space themselves, completely facilitating that space. How has watching the videos affected the wider community, would you say? How have people responded, and do you think they value the process?
Yeah, you know, we used to have film screenings before, when there was no TV sets in the village, and there used to be huge crowd. But then, like, with the coming of TV sets in, you know, different houses within the village, and that enthusiasm went off. We used to screen films on, you know, human rights, whether it is some workers' rights somewhere in other parts of the world, but it didn't grow that, you know, into that we used to screen some. Screen, like, it used to be a projector in the late 90s and then early 2000s, we were using those screens. Then, with the coming of the television set, that died down. But with PV, there was a lot more enthusiasm from the community, because for the first time they are seeing themselves speaking in the screen, and you know, like, so there was laughter, there was also, like, you know, people becoming emotional, and everybody was drawn towards, you know, the screen they look forward to. So whenever we call the community that we want to come and screen, then as Nick says, both young and old come. And we used to get very good feedback. Of course, like, even like in the process of documentation, if there is something that needs to be added, they participate in that, and they also share, like, what needs to be added more. And, you know, that kind of involvement and engagement was there, and something that was quite forthcoming from the community.
You were telling me some interesting stories and anecdotes about your work with the elders in the village and then using video. Can you maybe share some of the stories and the experiences that you've had?
Because, like, the kind of things that we are doing now is on traditional knowledge and all. And somehow, like, in our society, what my parents used to have in their years of the social institutions, like the men dormitory, the women dormitory, which used to be there, and there used to be a very strong, you know, communications between the elderly people and the younger people. So it's kind of like a socialization institution for the communities. But that was in the pre-Christian era. And my generation, we have gone to the schools, the formal institutions, and where we go to the classroom and then we learn things, unlike my parents' time. So when we are to have this, you know, like, to get different stories about, you know, our own communities, then we have to go back to our parents, because, you know, the kind of education we got, maybe in any other form of education, which has not really touched upon the community's knowledge. So we have to go back to the elders, and we have, you know, like, gone back to the elders. Sometimes we go for one-to-one interviews, sometimes we get together, few of them together, and have on a particular topic, we invite and request, and we have used to have a good time together. We have had to meet on customary practices. It's oral tradition, Naga oral tradition, we follow all the tradition. So we felt that it is important to have documentation done on the customary practices. We have invited the instances that we invite both men and women for sharing stories and all. But when the men are there, our women used to be, you know, like, was not really comfortable in opening up. So we have 2-3 sessions separately with men and with women also. Last year when we were having this, there were 4 elders. And after, like, few months, like 3-4 months or so after the documentation, one elder died. So like when we came back together with a larger group, the village council members, the kamburas, the village elders together to review what the video documentation is all about. I know they were also like feeling very emotional because the man, one of them, passed away. So it was also like, you know, bringing the memories back of, you know, how life is so, you know, short that it takes off once, like without really preparing for it. So that was also one, you know, like moving moment once we were reviewing it. We also had recently all women, only women together, elderly groups, because our experience tells us that sometimes we ourselves, when we're talking about, we need to have the voices of women in the mainstream, but for us also sometimes we sideline. So whenever we go and visit the women together, like one to one, either they will say, oh, I've forgotten, or oh, I don't remember, or oh, I'm growing old, I don't really. So our last one was with the same age group, because the dormitory, the women's dormitory, there is in their 70s, they have some 5 members who were part of the same dormitory. So when they came together, there was so much life. And like one forgets what the other one says, and there was so much, you know, like remembering, taking themselves back to those younger years where they have grown up as peer groups in the women's dormitory, and they were sharing lots of, you know, information also came out, especially the rituals that women take part in the agricultural work, in the purification, you know, like the rituals, ceremony and all. So there was so much to share. And for us also, it's new because we were born after Christianity came to our place. So we have not really had the opportunity of this kind of rituals and ceremonies that was once done by our grandmothers and our mothers. Those, yeah. So it was quite exciting having them on board. And it is not only like sharing the information, but it's also bringing back the memories. It's also like, you know, the rich social life which used to be there, which can be, you know, strengthened even with the present generation. So I think with bringing with the participatory video, it has also somehow that bridged the gaps between the younger and older generation. So storytelling sessions, and we do, you know, like once in a while we have done that, even in our campaigns, whether it is World Environment Day, we call them, the elderly people, to share about, you know, the nature science, and to share about the ecological, how they understand the ecosystem of what we call our universe. The elderly people, they call our universe the sky, which they can see from their village. So that itself is our universe. So even sharing about those things was quite, with participatory video, not only the nature of traditional knowledge has come, but I think there is, I could feel as member of the community that there is also like exchange, a bonding between the elderly and the younger people.
It makes me, hearing you makes me remember a story that Nukai told us. was one of the trainees from the eastern Nagaland region. She's married to a pastor, a church pastor. And it was really interesting to hear that they wanted to record some folk songs in their village. And for many years, the folk songs were banned, or certainly frowned upon by the church. And they were forgotten for 10, 20 years, maybe. And now there's a bit of a revival. And it was really interesting that when Nukai was asking the older women to sing, to share some songs, they were very shy and didn't want to, because they felt they weren't sure if they were allowed to, if it was okay to do that as Christians. And in the end, her husband, the pastor, said, of course it's fine, come and record in the church. So they actually recorded the songs, filmed them in the church, whereas perhaps 10, 20 years ago, the church was a very destructive force in terms of culture and folk songs. I thought that was quite an interesting shift that perhaps the video process has had has played a part in that. So could you share what about bad experiences using PV? Are there any things that you would do differently now, or the things that have gone wrong?
I cannot say like bad experiences with PV itself, but maybe like an incident once or twice like that, like difficult to get people on board and things like that. Otherwise, I believe the process of PV so far, we have not. And I think the kind of issues that we have touched also, like, it's, you know, like bringing back the traditional knowledge, bringing back, you know, stories about culture, resilience, and all. So it's something like that we have not really touched on the other issues, some sensitive issues, because Northeast India or Nagaland, which is a conflict from area state. So we have not really touched upon human rights violations as far as the state or non-state actors are concerned. So far it is within, you know, like area where it is to do with the land, stories of the land, stories of the community, stories of, you know, our way of living. So far there is no such And of course, like now, because 2014 and now is like more than 2.5 years. So now, initial days, like with the camera coming in, people run away and people, you know, feel shy. And then, that kind of things was there. But now, because they have seen and they have participated in the community screening and when they've been part of it. So like they're now very cooperative. Initial days, like even Lele and Bizoli, they had such problems that people did not really take them as somebody that will do something worthwhile, or what can they do. So that kind of, you know, like not very welcoming from the community itself, just because that they are young girls, they could not continue their studies. So those were also there. Now it's changed. And as I say, that we have not really touched on the issues which has considered to be sensitive and, you know, against the government or, you know, non-state actors so far.
Could you share what kind of sensitive issues you think might be interesting to look at with PV in the future? Have you got any thoughts on that?
We right now we have all our focus on the traditional knowledge systems, the culture and things like that. But then we will be also doing, especially on the governance issues, slowly that will be the next couple of things we wanted to concentrate on the poor governance issues, corrupted. So if we have to touch on those things, maybe like we may be blocked to some corrupt officials, maybe. So that may be a sensitive issue. And if we have to document even the war histories, which we have done bits, but we are not screened so far, but it talks about, you know, the atrocities of the army against the local people in the 50s and 60s, where our parents have gone through that. So those can be also sensitive because of some, you know, like it involves really horrific atrocities that our parents' time they have faced as young people.
One of the ways that we've seen quite exciting, powerful results in the participatory video in our work has been through horizontal sharing. I'm curious whether you've tried using PV for documenting innovation within agroecology of farming, for example, innovation, to document something that really works really well in order to help share it with other communities and other farmers. Have you tried anything like that? For example, around millet?
We have used our film, like the millet-based agriculture, which we have taken. Millets has been part of our this thing, but then it was kind of forgotten grain for some reasons, at least 2 decades. But when we started using this after our climate change research that we have done with the communities where we were doing that, it came out from the village farming communities that the kind of future food they want, they got these lost grains together with the new grains. So we were trying our best to spread the awareness about why we need to revive, why we need to bring back to our plates. But it didn't create that much ripple like the video. Once we showed the video to other communities, they suddenly like, oh yes, this is how we used to do, and you know, like, so it was quite powerful that way. And we have used the millet flame and also the seed flame which we have recently made. So that was also something that, oh okay, this is how we Chakasan people, they belong to Chakasan tribe. So, oh, this is how you Chakasan people, okay, this is how we do. So like that kind of cross-learning also, it has come out from the screening of those type of things.
I believe you brought some copies of the film to give it. That's what you
brought. I will be living in cities. Nick says cities doesn't really. But,
DVDs, yeah, we don't use them much anymore. But, yeah, we saw it.
I've got a few copies.
Yeah, I think just moving on really to the last few things I wanted to talk about, more about the future and the sustainability or not of participatory video. At the moment in your village you only have two young people left, because one has got married, as you said, and moved away. So there's a young man, Peter, and a young woman, Lele, who's and training in Saksha, plus of course your organisation and the support, the massive amount of support that you give those young people, which has made all the difference in my view. But what about the future? The training that you got from in Saksha wasn't a training of trainers. It was, you know, it was in 1 year, two workshops, that's it. And so they know how to make films, they know the rudiments of how to facilitate the PV process with a wider group, the games and so on that we use, but they haven't really had the level of capacity building that has taken place, for example, in other hubs like in Mexico, where they've now established a video collective and they basically do what we do, they facilitate participatory video to other indigenous communities completely autonomously from us. So do you see that as something that you are looking towards achieving, that level of capacity in Nagaland? What's your vision for PV? Or is it enough to do what you're doing on a local level, just to document?
Definitely we need to enhance the skills of the present video team. Yes, NEN has trained 12 women farmers from 5 villages. That's cool. But the concepts that PV got in really helped the 12 women farmers. So Lele and Vizoli has been, you know, mentoring them for some weeks before Vizoli left. And then the women farmers, because they have been just trained to use camera and also to collect footages and things like that, but not really editing. While these two have these editing skills also. What we need is that, like, we have been discussing even in our organization, like, how we need to enhance the skills of Lele and also Peter in other teams. And of course, definitely we believe in, you know, if we really want to have this, if we really want to reach out more people, then definitely there should be a team of who have that capacity to give trainings to others. Because you know, like, if it is only with few people, then you know there is chances. You never know, like, someday they may be for another place or another job, or and then So, and this is something very precious that we can't lose out. So for us, we strongly feel that we need a capacity building where they can become facilitators themselves. And of course, like a lot more of on the perspective and conceptual thing also, it's needed.
Mm.
And I also believe that because Northeast Network as a team has also very much, you know, like, have done hand-holding with the two young video persons, and that's how like they could manage to have more than other parts. So that kind of hand-holding from our side, and also from technical side, I think definitely there should be kind of like enhancement programs where they themselves can become facilitators.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen even like the responses from other states of Northeastern region where we have taken our videos to those communities. They have been like wanting even to learn. And for us, we don't have that kind of, you know, like technical know-how also.
Yeah.
In MEM, we have a new, you know, green hub, which is in another state, which also teaches about, you know, like using camera videos for wildlife conservation, which was which started just 2 years back. But definitely, of course,
mm-hmm.
we need to have a pool of trainers. If not like many, but at least 2-3 of them to be facilitators in spreading and even like teaching other groups who are very keen to be part of it.
Mm.
So hopefully, inside mm-hmm. also coming.
Mm. Well, we'd very much like to continue working with you. We are trying to raise funds to do that, so hopefully we will be able to do that next year. Do you have any questions you want to ask me?
As facilitators,
yeah.
Somebody who introduced BB, what is your feeling like? Must be like now many years you have started this work. So, like, places like in Nagaland that you are seeing, and places like in Mexico or Tanzania. So what, as a person who started this participatory video, what's your feeling, and also how do you see yourself like in the next few years?
Yes, you're right. I mean, I have been doing this for a long time, over 20 years. Inside Share is 18 years this month, 18 years old as an organisation. I mean, lately my role has changed quite a lot, and I find myself spending much too much time in front of a computer, writing emails, writing funding proposals, and it really gets me down sometimes, to be honest, because what I love is the work in the communities and on the ground. I mean, I don't want to travel as much as I used to travel because I've got the commitments, I've got family. I like to travel, I like to go and do PV projects with indigenous communities. That's my passion. Maybe once a year, twice a year, to, you know, if I can. And I'm lucky enough to be able to pretty much choose the ones that I do. But for a lot of the year, it is tough, actually. I've been finding it really, really tough and challenging lately, because I think that because of the contrast between what I see in your work and the work of our partners on the ground, and how incredibly exciting it is and how important it is, in my view, what you're doing in terms of resilience, building resilience, preserving, promoting your culture and identity, bringing together the communities, bringing together the generations, promoting and sharing real alternatives, and I look around me and the world is just getting more and more crazy. I mean, it's definitely, for me, it's, from my perspective, it's got much worse in the last 20 years. In the last 20 years since I've been an activist, the situation's much worse. I never thought it would be like this. So I do feel despondent sometimes, I have to admit, because, you know, I'd like to get a lot more support for what for the work that you guys are doing, and I want to spread it. I know there's a lot of demand. Indigenous communities are calling us to come and do trainings and work with them in many parts of the world. And these projects often are just, they just remain on paper for years, 2, 3, 4 years, and we're not able to get the resources to get on and do the work that needs to be done. So that is really frustrating. But it's events like this week where you are coming to us and spending time with me and my team, that's what's going to feed us, nourish us and give us the inspiration to continue persevering and trying to get the support that, we think we deserve and that you deserve to make this work, to really scale out this work in a way it needs to be scaled out. Because I think we're actually contributing to a sane alternative to the insanity that the world is in at the moment. And I think, you know, so I'm really proud of the work I do, to answer your question. I feel very proud of what we've achieved. I'm very happy and proud that we're still here after 18 years as an organisation. I think that's an achievement in itself. But I'm also frustrated and, you know, ready for change, ready for things to step up and scale up, because we're ready for it. You know, we have an incredible team of associates, of everyone. It's all, we're there, it's all there in place. We've got the impacts, we've got the evidence, you know, from people like you and the groups on the ground, the stories of change, it's all there. So bring it on, basically. Let's let 2018 be the year that when it really takes off. So yeah, thank you.
No challenges up there.
Yeah, yeah. Of course.
People on the ground.
Yes, yeah, for sure.
That's true.
Yeah. Does anyone else have a question for either Nick or Senna?
I do. I do. I was just thinking, I'm Australian, and I'm thinking back to the Aborigines, our traditional people. And I was just wondering if you had any reluctance to share some of the traditional knowledge, because within the Aboriginal culture, it is passed. It's very, very, some of it's very secret, and it's passed directly from the holder to the next holder of that knowledge, and they might not want that to be more widely known. Has that interfered or hindered any of your PV videos at all? Or is that an issue for you?
See, we have been documenting in our own community the videos, and so far there was willingness to share. And there was no such like that inhibition that, okay, I'm sharing this, it might be misused. There was no such incident. There was trust. So far that thing has not happened, though we are also like, we do, when we go to the communities, we do share about, like, you know, how we need to even protect our own knowledge systems and how we should be careful when it is to do with, you know, like, those kind of stuff, biopiracy, what people call it. We also share about those, you know, great awareness amongst the communities, different communities we work with. But as long as, like, the PV that we have used that to document the knowledge, I think there was a complete trust. We have been in the, this network is a regional kind of a small network, women's organization, but the people who are working are from the same community, from the local communities. I along with my colleagues, most of us are from that community, so there was complete trust, and I think we have not breached any, you know, trust of the community people. So far there is no such things. And of course, like, they were also there. Not from the community, but from the groups like us that raise issues that we are Notice Network. So it's been Notice Network is a little bit different from the local Naga group. So those kind of, you know, like, we also hear sometimes from the groups, but not from the community. The community has complete trust so far. and handing over, you know, like the knowledge from parents to their children. That was not very strong, like in our community. It was more or less like it was shared, like even the healing systems. It was not that I hold to myself, my own family, that was not there in my community.
In Mexico, several films that the Yaqui and Compact groups have made have been specifically made just for local use and not shared out to outsiders.
To sort of address that issue.
Yeah. So I think there's a very conscious decision and decision at the start of when they want to, they decide on a topic and that they want to make a film about. That, you know, some films are made to share externally, and they're posted, they have their own YouTube channel, for example, so they post their own, when they're ready, they put them up there, and sometimes they subtitle them. Other films are not shared in that way at all, yeah. So they have like a digital archive on hard drives, but mm-hmm. some things are not shared with outsiders.
Related to that, I found, because when we did the training here with Insight Share, we had the discussion about doing the consent before and after, and I found that really useful with my work in Senegal. With so we had the challenge, for example, with generations. So sometimes it was just the youngsters doing a film, and they would play the wise person of the village. And so at the end, they were embarrassed because they knew the wise man they were representing would watch that. So we rediscussed, are you happy for this to be seen? And same for women, they said things they wouldn't have said with their husbands nearby, but then it was like, well, your husband is going to watch the film tonight, are you happy with that? And it was very interesting to see the reaction because, for example, with the elderly man, he said, oh, I'm surprised to hear this youngster saying what I would have said, because I thought only I had this, not the knowledge, because, you know, he said it a lot of times, we said, oh, you know, that's always my role to keep saying these things, but actually you've been listening, and you know what I've been saying. And so it was really, I think for participants, there's two challenges, when you're seeing the video, but also seeing it viewed by the people nearby was it's quite a difficult experience sometimes, and you hear the nervous laughter, like, ooh, is this okay? It's good to hear the feedback of participants and the viewers at the end. Very interesting.
Yeah.
I've got a quick question as well. you talked about how participatory video could create new rituals or like recreate rituals that have been lost in the past, like the healing rituals or where older people and younger people are sharing their knowledge together. I wonder whether you feel like participatory video has the potential to push other cultural or social boundaries, and whether you would like to use it in that way in Nagaland.
See, the practices which, you know, like related to the land or to the agriculture, I mean, it's not only the food, it's also like culture, it's also like spiritual and things like that. And suddenly we see the change roles between men and women. I'm just setting an example of the rituals and ceremonies, which was done with, you know, like a very special relationship with the land or with their farmland or with the forest or the springs. Now the change role of, you know, because now our village is, you know, there is no enemies now. Everybody is converted to Christianity. And in church, the head of institution is pastor, and pastor is man. So even like, you know, gaining that role of, you know, having, you know, blessings to be said, or asking, praying, everything is. So women, that role that has been, you know, somehow. But I felt that, you know, as a person who was an observing person, not the one who's taking care of the documentation video, Sometimes it strikes me, like, okay, even the role, the new religion has come and the role has been, you know, changed. And some of the these roles are, you know, very important, which women have played as part of, you know, like taking part in the ceremony and, you know, the rituals that were done earlier. So in that participatory video is now bringing in the elderly women. They have shared how they have done. So we have not yet taken back to the community screening. We'll be doing that. And if, you know, like with the support of the community people, we know we have to push, like we push for Millets Festival. Millets Festival needs to be there. But it has been like, you know, because if our festivals are coming in the time of Christmas time, that has been replaced by Christmas, and then the sewing festival, that is like after finishing the sewing, that's in April, so that has been replaced by Easter, Good Friday. So, you know, like even this kind of changes have happened like, without much resistance also, it is just difference. And now people have really no connection with the, you know, like the harvest festival, that is Christmas festival, and then the sewing festival, that is the, so we feel that like slowly we can also bring back this kind of another relationship, the importance, the significance of a particular festival that's linked with the agriculture, or you know, something to do with the interaction with the natural environment in the village. We hope so. I don't know whether I answered your question.
Yeah. I guess I was also thinking about some transitions that weren't reconnecting with the past, but also looking to the future of what could be, possibilities that haven't been before.
See, one of course, definitely one important aspect is reconnecting with the past. It can be also healing, it can be also, it's not only like bringing back the knowledge that, you know, but it's also like, because as I've shared with you, it's also like we have seen for our Naga community, if we look into the history, we are not known to the world before the Britishers came. Only like in the 19th century when the Britishers came, and then when we, Naga Hills were also part of the British administration, in India. After that, only like Nagas were known to the rest of the world, nor Nagas have come in contact with the rest of the world. And along with that, like after the Britishers left India, then we have this whole internal problem with the mighty nation, India. And that's where the real, you know, like atrocities, the stories, those are something that we cannot even like digest, that our parents have gone through that kind of atrocities. Every family has a story to tell. Like even till my generation, we have stories to tell as children. So that is one part, like looking back at the past. It can be, you know, participating video can be used to bring back some of the dying knowledge systems that is in the community. It can also bring, you know, like some kind of healing when we share this kind of stories that we have gone through, sharing the kind of the kind of life that have gone through in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, which we have not really seen it. But we have also been part of the post-conflict, where we have also our own stories to share. So that's one part. The other part, of course, like if we are to look at the future, definitely the PV that has also brought the communities together. So in a way, it has played like peace within the communities, bringing the communities together. We are of like in Nagaland, we have, you know, like 16 major tribes living in a small state. Besides the church, which somehow like brings together, we have no that kind of, you know, like opportunities to really interact with the next tribe living in the next district and things like that. And we hope that participatory video will bring us. We hope that participatory video will also share the stories of resilience. What we have in our community may not be in the tribe, in the other part our state or our region or even like the globe, I should say. The kind of stories that, you know, like stories of resilience can be exchanged, solidarities be built. I think for me, like, I feel that now the mighty, what we call it, the MNCs, the multinational companies may be crying, and it has come to every nook and corner, even the remotest place of the globe. So it's not that only we people are facing that, it's not only people in the African countries are facing, it's not only people in the South America countries are facing, but it's also like maybe in Europe, maybe in England, there are small communities who are still practicing, you know, ecological practices, you know, building on the resilience that they have been inbuilt over a period of time. I think these kind of stories we need to exchange, we need to learn from each other, and we have to be like, okay, in our own small part in Nagaland, whether it is Mexico, whether it's Tanzania, or whatever it is, we have to, you know, strengthen the kind of network we have. And I believe that with coming to know inside sharing link and like that itself, the next few days we'll be meeting other friends from the parts of the country, the world. And even meeting you all here, I feel that because it's also like, I was just telling Nick that the institution name, Center for Agroecology, whatever, is so nice. So I believe that, you know, like even coming and meeting each other here in this small place, I'm sure that this will take us to another level where, you know, we can exchange, share stories and build on it.